There is a kind of a paradigm that we all work under. It's a paradigm that I grew up learning about when I took my university courses in quantum mechanics. I ended up doing a PhD in theoretical physics, and we used quantum theory all the time. I used a tremendous amount of quantum theory applied to fields, and so we learned quantum field theory. And so there's a certain way of thinking about quantum mechanics and thinking about how it's supposed to work, starting from the textbook axioms, the so-called Dirac, for Paul Dirac, von Neumann from John von Neumann axioms that you get from respectively 1930 and 1932, that's written in all the textbooks. And these axioms are, you know, quick to summarize. Every quantum system has a Hilbert space. Every system has a quantum state defined in some mathematical terms, either as a state vector or a density, some object that lives in this Hilbert space. This object, when the system is evolving through time in a way where it's not mutually exchanging interactions or information with any other systems, evolves according to a rule called smooth unitary time evolution, which can usually be, for some systems, expressed as a differential equation. That's the Schrodinger equation. And then you have all these measurement axioms, all these axioms about, you know, what are the mathematical objects that represent the things that we can observe about the system? How do we get probabilities out of the theory for those measurement outcomes? That's called the Born rule. And then we're supposed to collapse the quantum state to reflect the result of the measurement and give robust, reliable predictions for subsequent measurements. Those are the standard picture. And this picture is built around the idea of the quantum state. You know, there's this paradigm, I call it the wave function paradigm, that quantum theory begins by talking about wave functions or some suitable generalization of wave functions that live in Hilbert spaces. And then we're supposed to sort of figure out what we're supposed to do from there. When you start from this picture, it sounds very complicated to construct a different picture, because you start with all these Hilbert space ingredients. You're like, well, we've got a Hilbert space. Hilbert space is a kind of vector space. Vector spaces can be described using what are called different orthonormal bases. So what you have to do is you have to pick an orthonormal basis for some reason, and then from that orthonormal basis, you have to do this and do this, and you have interference, and you have the Hilbert space, and you have the Schrodinger equation, which has to be translated back. I mean, when you start from this paradigm, it makes everything sound very complicated. And you see this all the time when you're talking about, you know, different paradigms for a theory, that from maybe a newer paradigm, you know, a newer paradigm can look very complicated when one attempts to express it in terms of an older one, or even very difficult to understand. And there's this whole theory, this whole story in the history and philosophy of science about the incommensurability of different paradigms. So let me just start from the beginning, okay?
I don't believe that paradigms really are incommensurable, but, you know, that's a separate discussion.
That's fine. I won't take a stand on this. I'm not ideological about this. I'm only saying that there is in the history and philosophy of science this idea that paradigms can be incommensurable. I won't take a stand on it. Yeah.
What I would say, Jacob, is that, you know, if you say that this is, you know, a new paradigm for quantum mechanics, and that, we shouldn't try to express it in terms of the old paradigm, then the task for you, the next task would be to explain, you know, take all the successes of quantum mechanics, you know, all the phenomena that we know about, you know, including, you know, Shor's algorithm, Grover's algorithm, you know, quantum teleportation, and show how they have simpler explanations in terms of indivisible stochastic dynamics, right? And what you won't be allowed to do when you do that is say, well, just translate it back into the usual, you know, Ket notation, the usual Hilbert space picture, and then, you know, just invoke this theorem that says that it has an equivalent representation in my picture. Because, you know, if that's going to be your answer, then, you know, you're telling me that in practice, I should just continue using the standard picture. Right. And I should continue to think in terms of it. Right. If you want me to switch to thinking in terms of a different picture, then you have to show me how all the specific successes of quantum mechanics that I care about actually are simpler to explain, present in terms of that new picture.
So let me say a couple of things about that first, and then I'll get to. Yeah. So one of the things I'm going to do is explain what this approach is on its own terms. But of course, one of the important things about this approach is that it leads to an ability to reconstruct the standard axioms and the Hilbert space picture in its regime of validity, and say a little bit about why it has this sort of limited regime of validity and how one might extend that. But I'm not saying, to be super clear, right, I'm not saying that we should stop using the Hilbert space picture any more than, you know, if you want to study a problem in classical physics using the action angles formulation, or you want to do Hamilton-Jacobi theory, or you want to help yourself to canonical transformations or canonical perturbation theory, or one of a million other things that you might want to do, visualize trajectories in phase space, you're going to use the Hamiltonian phase space reformulation of classical physics. So if someone comes along and says, oh, you know about Hamiltonian, the Hamiltonian phase space formulation, you've got Qs representing positions or some generalization of positions and Ps representing some generalized notion of momenta, the so-called canonical momenta, and you have this phase space picture and you've got the dynamics, the equations that describe how things evolve according to Hamilton's equations of motion, and you have these beautiful symmetries, you have this like ability to do changes of canonical variables, these so-called canonical transformations that can scramble what the whole picture looks like. You know, and someone comes along and says, actually, I think that there's a physical picture here. The thing you're describing is an object moving around, you know, maybe it's stuck to a spring or on a pendulum, you know, and the person says, well, okay, that's a useful picture, that's helpful, but will it help me do canonical perturbation theory? Will it help me do action angle variables? I would say, well, no, we have this beautiful Hamiltonian framework for doing that. You should use that still. Or another example is, we have general relativity. So general relativity, this is, I've been teaching general relativity for 10 years, but when we do orbital calculations in like, you know, sending spacecraft around, we still use the Newtonian paradigm. It's still very useful.
I understand the point, Jacob. Yeah. I mean, but general relativity, at least, you know, there is some class of situations where, you know, this new language is better, right? So I think in this case, you at least have to show that there is some class of problems, of quantum mechanics problems, that are better treated using your new formulation than using the old one. Or else other people could justly say, then what is the point of learning it?
Or even can only be treated using your formulation.
Right. Right. So, let me start with that question.
Yeah.
I want to get to explaining what it is, but let me just quickly jump to that, okay?
Okay.
So if what you're doing is, again, developing algorithms for quantum computing, I don't think there's no obvious sense in which this gives you the ability to do anything differently from what you would do in the old paradigm. The tools that we have are extremely good for these situations. You're studying tabletop kinds of systems where the Dirac-von-Neumann axioms work really great. But those are not the only kinds of systems that physicists are interested in. So physicists are interested in applying quantum mechanics in astrophysical situations to early universe cosmology. And people are trying to apply quantum mechanics in the context of quantum gravity. They're trying to do quantum mechanics applied to black holes. They're trying to do quantum, you know, and now you're in situations where the Dirac-von-Neumann axioms are very ambiguous about what you're supposed to be able to say. And this is where I sort of cut my teeth. I mean, again, I did my PhD here at Harvard in high energy theoretical physics. These are the kinds of problems that I studied. And I was often very confused about, you know, when we were legitimated in using the textbook version of quantum theory. And again, I wasn't the only one. I mean, we would routinely run into situations in which people would say, well, can we do this particular thing? Does this make sense? We have this sort of nonlinear dependence on this or that, and what's going on with black holes? And people were genuinely confused about how to apply quantum theory to these situations. But these are situations that are different from what you'd find in tabletop experiments. It'd be like saying, why do I need general relativity on Earth? Newtonian gravity works fantastically. Well, there are systems that are beyond Earth where we may need a better theory because things get more extreme.
Let's agree that if you could say something new about quantum gravity, that would be great, right? No argument there. Now, if we think of you as, you know, you are sort of hawking a new product at the foundations of quantum mechanics bazaar, right? Well, okay, the quantum gravity theorists are potential customers, right? I am also a potential customer, right? I am in the market for even just a reformulation of existing quantum mechanics that would help in coming up with new quantum algorithms, right? Or understanding for which problems quantum computers will give a speed up and for which they won't. If someone can give me that, that's great. I'll buy it.
Right. But so there's like a lot of things that one might want to do with reformulating quantum theory. One is, you know, the existing approaches that we have, the existing, if you want, formulations, interpretations. I honestly know that the terms don't exactly mean the same thing, and there are some people who really like to be very precise about what they mean, but I'm happy to call this a formulation interpretation. That doesn't bother me.
At some point that might actually be the crux. Like, are you making a new ontological claim, or are you just giving a new mathematical reformulation?
Both. Okay. So I'll be very clear for everybody. It's both. Okay. There's both an ontological statement about what is actually out there, and also sort of a new mathematical formulation. Okay. And, you know, to be clear, like when Paul Dirac introduced the path integral in, you know, his paper in 1932, Lagrangians in Quantum Mechanics. He was just curious how Lagrangians show up in the in quantum mechanics, this classical idea of Lagrangians, because the theory at that point had been developed only in the Hamiltonian formulation. And it took 10 years before Richard Feynman came along and incorporated this idea into his PhD thesis. Then 6 more years in 1948 in Reviews of Modern Physics, and when he spelled out the idea for a broader physics audience. And even then, he said in the paper, there's nothing you can do here that you can't do using ordinary methods. It took decades for people to realize that there are situations in which you would never want to do things in the canonical Hamiltonian formulation. In particular, things like Yang-Mills theories, right? And the Standard Model is formulated in the Lagrangian path integral formulation for very good reasons. Sometimes ideas do take a while to come to fruition. Sure. And another good example is David Bohm's work. So decoherence goes back to David Bohm's work in 1951. He was doing trying to understand foundational questions of the measurement process in his textbook, Quantum Theory, from 1951. And in chapter 22, he studies the measurement process. And famously in section 22.8, destruction of interference in the process of measurement, he introduces this idea of how decoherence works. You know, and it takes decades for that eventually to become a major part of how we think about quantum computing, right? I mean, decoherence timescales are now a thing that people just talk about constantly. Things do take time, but you have to begin with a new idea. And I think it's just interesting when you have a new idea that isn't obviously wrong or inconsistent.
New update. Started a Substack. Writings on there are currently about language and ill-defined concepts, as well as some other mathematical details. Much more being written there. This is content that isn't anywhere else. It's not on Theories of Everything. It's not on Patreon. Also, full transcripts will be placed there at some point in the future. Several people ask me, hey, Curt, you've spoken to so many people in the fields of theoretical physics, philosophy, and consciousness. What are your thoughts? While I remain impartial in interviews, this Substack is a way to peer into my present deliberations on these topics. Also, thank you to our partner, The Economist.